Well, hello. Welcome again to the Grace Community Church virtual service. If you're watching this now, then I guess you survived Christmas, and I hope that that was a blessing for you. It's a blessing for us to be here worshiping with you this morning. Sit back and enjoy. Thank you for watching.
Pray with me, please. A most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We're looking so much to 2021 and your grace and your mercy that you're going to show for all of us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for the privilege of giving. We pray now that as your people give at the beginning of the year, all of the accounts, at least in the church, are now zero. We have no money in the accounts for this year. It's just all projected income. So we pray that as you help us to continue our year-by-year existence, month-by-month, in, in our time, that you'll give us what we need to exist and even prosper us, Lord. Make a distinction for us as you did for Israel when they were in Goshen. You blessed them and you protected them in spite of great difficulty. We're in great difficulties in our day and age. There's an uncertainty about what's happening globally, politically, financially. But with you, there is no uncertainty. There is simply certainty. You are coming again. Your kingdom will be established. You will replace all human governance. You will do away with all false leadership, and your kingdom shall never end. To that end, Lord, we serve you here in this world as ambassadors. But while we are here, give to us, Lord, all the tools that we need to serve you and to represent you adequately. Amen. Happy New Year. Welcome to 2023. Today's message is to kind of finalize the series on the birth of Christ. Obviously, there's a lot more that needs to be studied and looked at. I trust that you have the time to read it more intensely and try to see what God is showing us through the birth of Christ. Here, we're going to see the visit of the wise men. I know they're called magi, and some say they're kings. I think that they are the descendants of the disciples of none other than Daniel, who was the head chief for three kings in the kingdom of Babylon and Persia. And he established a school for the wise men, and he taught them the ways of the Lord. So I really think that that's who these individuals are. They saw his star in the east. They were in modern-day Iraq. Jerusalem was east of them, so they saw something happening in the east. So we're going to look at this. Seekers actually search for the Lord. People who don't look for the Lord, they don't find him because they don't look. If you don't look for gold, you don't find gold. If you don't, the examples go on and on. You have to get in the game if you want to get the result or the benefit from it. If you want the Lord, you must seek for him. Hebrews says this, he who comes to the Lord must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. So if you're a seeker of the Lord will show himself to you. If you're just goofing off and really don't care about it and look at it as semi-important and maybe I do it because it's Christmas time or it's Easter or my wife does it, or then you're never going to come into a personal relationship with God. You must seek him. If you're truly seeking the Lord, then you have to begin the search. When Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, Herod the king is a historical personage mentioned not just in the Bible, but in other historical documents, okay? So the Bible is not set in some mythological frame. It is a historical context that is verifiable by history and archaeology. King Herod did really exist. Behold, wise men came from the east to Jerusalem, saying, where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and we have come here to worship him. So they're searching for the Lord. They've left their country. They picked up and traveled far, actually, for many, many weeks, probably, because they saw something happening. And they knew the particulars of this because they knew that he was a king. They knew that he was to be born in Israel. By logical extension, Jerusalem's the capital. A king is born in the capital, at least in human ways. And so they go to Jerusalem and they find there instead a king who isn't anything connected to the Bible. Herod is not a Jew. He was appointed by Caesar Augustus, and he wasn't a believer in the scriptures other than whatever he could do to make the Jewish people under his authority feel comfortable or that he was being nice to them. But historically, he was a really, really controversial, violent leader. And there's tremendous historical examples of this concerning him. And one of them is right here in the story of Jesus Christ's infancy. False leadership does not seek him, nor do they inspire others to seek him. He's in charge of the leadership of Israel. He does not seek the Lord, and the people that are in his sway, his cabinet, his advisors, they're not seeking really either. Interesting that it takes people from another country, another culture, and another place to stir up this, what's going on here? Why are these guys here? They should be seeking. They should be looking at the scriptures. Why aren't they being shown the star? Why aren't they being drawn by God to look after him? It's because none of them care. Their leadership doesn't care, and they're not being inspired by their leadership to care. That's happening in the United States today. Leaders, so-called, not just in politics, but in church, in everyday life, they are actually modeling a leadership where God doesn't matter. You don't need God. You don't need Christ. You don't need that old-fashioned stuff. It's all past. It's all old stuff. We're in a new era, a new age. We don't need God. We don't need the Bible. We don't need Christianity because it was used by white supremacists to oppress us. Well, Christianity, true Christianity, is not from white people. It is from the Jewish people who are from the Middle East. They were people of color. And if anyone has ever been oppressed just for being of one ethnicity, the Jewish people have the biggest trophy because they've been oppressed from day one. So let's try to get things right here. Yes, I agree. I understand that people groups have used faith and Christianity and religion for the purposes of subjecting and oppressing other people. I will not excuse that. That is not right, okay? But we don't have the right to then say, therefore, it's all wrong. It is not all wrong. Just because people have done wrong in the name of Jesus doesn't make Jesus wrong. The leadership of the people, even in the time of Jesus, proved this out. I'll show you. Whenever the king heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. So what did he hear? People from another country asking questions. Where's the king that's born? Where's the... We're seeing these supernatural signs about the birth of this Savior. Where is it? Where is he? We want to visit him. We want to worship him. So this troubles Herod for particular reasons. One, he was an insecure individual who looked at any kind of a threat to his authority as a threat. And if he felt that somebody was going to be replacing him, he was going to attack that, okay? That's why it troubled him. The other people in Jerusalem were troubled as well because this is unusual. This has never happened before. All of a sudden, people from another culture and language show up and they're asking where the king is. Ungodly leaders do not know the Bible. There are leaders. There have always been leaders. Until the end of this world, there will be leaders. Many are worldly believers who don't believe in God, don't believe in the Bible, don't believe in Jesus, don't believe in church, don't believe in life. They believe in themselves. They believe in their power. They believe in their influence. They believe that they're here on earth and that they're leaders because they are different than everybody else. And everybody else should listen to them because they're in charge. Leadership is not that. Leadership, as shown to us by Jesus Christ and by God himself, is humble. It is servanthood. It is for the benefit of others. That is true leadership. But ungodly leaders don't know this because they don't know the Bible. Now, even within the church, there's those who take leadership in the church because they think it's influence and power and look at me or listen to me. I know it all. True leadership in the Bible is biblical. If it is not biblical, it's not leadership, even if it's inside of a church or a denomination. So he gathered all the chief priests and scribes and people together and demanded of them where Christ should be born. So who gathered them? Herod did. He's the political leader, he's king, he's dictator. He grabs all of the scholars of the Jewish people and he says, okay, this is your stuff. I'm not Jewish. This is your religion. They're here to ask about something in your religion, so tell me what it means. They said to him, he will be born in Bethlehem of Judea. For thus it is written by the prophet, thou Bethlehem in the land of Judea, are not least amongst the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. So they go to the right biblical place. They knew it, they found it. They quote to him the scripture. But he doesn't know the scripture. Not only does he not know the scripture, he doesn't believe the scripture. He is a pagan king, so he is superstitious, so he does feel the threat of somebody being proclaimed to be a king to sit on the throne that he's on. So he's threatened right now, and he's going to use this knowledge negatively. The people of God, the Jewish people, the scribes and the priests, they should have been more careful about this. They should have been more careful. They already knew what he was like because he had already proven through his actions before. Although he may have garnered favor with the leadership of Israel at that time because he built the temple, he beautified Jerusalem, all of those things, and they may have been wowed by his power and his influence and his riches and his connections. He had connections to Rome through Caesar. So they may have been wowed by that. And so maybe they themselves were trying to kind of cozy up to him by giving him this information. But they're going to find out that the sharing of this information with him is going to result in a tragedy for the people of Israel. Jesus answered, I'm going to Jesus, he's now an adult, this is in Matthew 22, and he said this to the leadership of Israel, you do err, not knowing the scriptures or the power of God. For in the resurrection they neither marry nor are given in marriage, they are as the angels in heaven. So when I say that ungodly leaders don't know the Bible, because they don't know the Bible, they are in error. They are in error because they don't know the scriptures. And the the lack of the knowledge of the scriptures in any people group, even the Jewish people, leads to tragedy. It leads to disaster to not know the scriptures. Indeed, when Jesus is answering this question here, the superstition that they had allowed to come into their thinking, this is the leadership called the Sadducees in the time of Jesus. They were kind of like the aristocratic section of Jewish culture and people. They didn't believe in many different things about the Bible. And Jesus tells them, you're in error. You don't understand the scriptures at all. And when a people, no matter who they are, if they don't know the scriptures and they don't believe the scriptures, they're going to fall into error. That is happening in our day and age. There is a lot of error all around us, socially, politically, financially, in every way, scientifically, academically. There is failure, there is error, because they're starting out from the wrong premise. And what is the premise that they are starting out from in academia, in science, in politics, in economics, and in anything? They are starting out with a premise. Premise means the foundation, the starting point. They are starting from this thought. There is no God. We evolved from nowhere. There is no Savior. Christianity doesn't matter. The Bible's not really, has nothing to do with the modern age. So they're starting from that. They are going to fall into great error. So when you as a believer look around you and you see all that is happening in our culture and in our time, don't be surprised. It's because our leadership doesn't believe in the Bible anymore. Our leadership doesn't believe in God anymore. Our leadership, even within the churches and many denominations, they're throwing it all out the window. So therefore, it is incumbent upon you, the believer, if you're a believer in God from the Bible, the God of the Bible, if you're a true servant of God, you need to seek out teachers and preachers and churches that still hold to the truth of God in the Bible. If they do not, you must abandon them, because God will require it of you when you stand in front of Him. He will ask you, why did you stay in that church that did not believe the Bible? Why did you stay under that preacher who preached something that was against my word? You need to really take this more seriously. Now, politicians say whatever is expedient. Indeed, humans who are unregenerate, unborn again, and sometimes born again, they say things for the purpose of getting ahead. And that's what Herod is going to do. Watch what he does here. He secretly calls the wise men and inquires of them diligently when the star appeared. He has an ulterior motive here. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, okay, go and search diligently for the young child. When you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. Well, that's a big lie, right? That's a lie. He's not telling the truth. That's not his motive. He knows already what he's going to do. When he finds the person that is threatening his throne, he's going to do away with them. Now, he tells the people that are looking for the born, the king, he tells them, okay, you go find him and you go ahead and search for him and tell me when you find him. And then come and tell me so that I can go worship him too. So he's only placating them. He's trying to make them think that he's okay, that he's on board with this. So he understands that, okay, you left your country. You came here to look for the king. All right, he's not here in Jerusalem, but the Jewish scriptures say he's over there in Bethlehem. So why don't you go down there, find him, and come and tell me, and that way I can go and worship him too. Ha, ha, ha. Not really. There's an evil laugh here in the background. God guides those who truly seek. Remember, these individuals left their home country. They've been traveling for many, many weeks, maybe months, because in those days there were no trains or any kind of transport like we have nowadays. It was by horseback or camel, or they walked. Now, I know all of the Christmas cards they show with guys on camels, on a caravan and all of that, but it doesn't say any of that. It does not say. But we assume that they brought with them at least pack animals. When they had heard the king, the wise men, they departed. And the star which they saw in the east went before them until it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they were rejoiced with exceeding great joy. The star, let's talk about this. God has been guiding these people since they left their home country. Why is he guiding them? Because they're seeking. He will guide you to find him, to find the Lord, to find the truth, if he sees that you're truly looking. God is sovereignly, supernaturally guiding these strangers to the Jewish people. He's guiding them supernaturally to the truth, okay? In their case, it happens to be a star. Well, what's the star? People have gone into great lengths. Oh, this was the conjunction of Jupiter and Mars and Saturn and all of this stuff. People try to make a big deal out of this. But it's really interesting when you read this for what it says. The star went before them and stood over the place where the child was. So this star, if you know anything about Bible study, there's certain words that are synonymous with other words. Star and angel are synonymous. I believe, and I can't prove it until we get to eternity, but I actually believe that God had sent to them an angel, just like he sent an angel to Mary and Joseph and Zechariah. He sent to them an angel, and this angel was guiding them, and this angel wasn't visible to anyone else because no one else was looking. If this star was visible to everybody, then Herod would have just followed that star, and that star would have showed him where this threat was. But this star, apparently, was particularly a revelation only to the wise men. I think that's significant, okay? And they see this star standing over the place where the young child was. So in the Christmas cards, you see this big star in the heavens and light shining down on the manger. But that's not really biblical because it's the wise men who see this, not everybody else. The wise men see this. So let's look. When you find the Lord, you will find worship. Remember, they started out on this journey long time ago. Jesus has already been born. They went to the capital city of Israel. They didn't find him there. That still doesn't discourage them. They hear, okay, he's going to be born in this insignificant town way out there in the boonies. So they go there. They're looking for him, and God guides them there, and they find him. They came to the manger. No. What does the Bible say? When they came into the house. Well, wait, I thought Jesus was born in a manger. Well, he was. He was born in a manger. But Joseph was a good provider. He went and obtained housing. He moved Mary and the baby into a house. He didn't let them stay in the barn. He was responsible. So he did whatever he needed to do to see to it that they were provided for and brought them into a house. So these wise men encountered Jesus not at the manger with the drummer boy, that's all superstition, but in a house. They saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped Mary. I'm misreading it again on purpose. Who did they worship? They worshiped him. They did not worship Mary. Why not? Because Mary is not the person that you should worship. The only person the Bible reveals since Genesis, especially in the Ten Commandments, thou shalt have no other God before me. You are to worship God, the one true God. That's who you are to worship. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. So they came prepared to worship him. They came prepared to give him honor because they had been discipled in the school of the wise men way back in the ancient Persian Empire. They had been discipled by Daniel, who showed them the scriptures, who showed at least their ancestors the scriptures, because remember, this is 400 years after Daniel. So many generations after Daniel, these men are still being taught about the truths of the scripture. And they knew that someone was going to be born in Israel at the time. Now, how did Daniel know this? He knew this from Bible study, and he transmitted this information to the wise men. And they came prepared to worship. And when they found the Lord, when they found the one that is to be born king in Israel, they found worship. If you're not a worshiper, I know a lot of people that don't like to listen to music, and they'll miss music on purpose and just listen to preaching. I don't know where that sentiment comes from. You better get used to worship, because when you get into eternity, there's going to be nothing but unending worship and praise to the Lord. You better get used to it. It's not As a matter of fact, it says no one will need to be taught there. No one will need to be instructed there. Because the knowledge of the Lord will fill all of his people, and he himself will be their God. No one will need any preacher or teacher or evangelist. Everyone will be exposed to God fully. So the only thing left to us in eternity will be eternal worship. Okay? So you need to get into worship if you're not into it. You need to get into it. I don't care if you don't like the music that you think you like or don't like. You should learn to worship God. When they opened their treasures, they presented to him gifts. Have you presented to the Lord gifts? Have you started to understand how blessed it is to give instead of just receive? Give. Give to the Lord. You'll never regret it. False leaders destroy life, and true leaders protect it. Leadership in the world. When I'm a history buff, I'm a straight A student in history. I'm not making this up. I can show you my transcripts if you want. But I'm not boasting about it. I just know that when you look at history and human leadership in history, human leadership always seems to be attained in the human sphere by force and by power of might and riches. And the people who gain leadership in a worldly sense do so in that way. And I think that that's all going to end. At least I know that scripturally from the book of Daniel, that God is going to destroy that kind of human leadership. He's going to replace it with godly leadership. And godly leadership was modeled to us through Jesus Christ, who taught the disciples that the Gentiles lorded over one another. But you shall not be like that, because to be a leader in the kingdom of God is to be a servant like me. False leaders destroy life. They do whatever they need to do to get power. I'm fearful that that's what happened in our last election, that people were elected simply by guaranteeing the right to do abortion. And I am not going to take a stand on abortion one way or the other than to say to you this: you need to stand in front of God one day. No matter what you've done, you'll have to stand in front of God. No matter if there's a legislature or a governing body that says that you can do this or that, not just abortion, but anything, and they tell you that it's legal, and then you die and you stand in front of God, who tells you, guess what? It was always illegal. It doesn't matter if human governments pass immoral, unethical, illegal, in the eyes of God, laws. You and I must stand in front of God one day. You can't run to the human court system or the human government leaders to try to justify what you've done. You won't be able to lay the blame on them. You are responsible to God. So to me, the issue of abortion or sexual preference or lifestyle, all of that is really between you and God, not the government and you. So the government can, you can elect people that'll say that everything that you do is cool. But guess what? You still have to face God. So you can feel like everything that you're doing here on earth is legal, and maybe it is humanly, but in front of God, there are many things that have been sanctioned by human leadership that is ungodly. And in the end of time, God will judge it all, no matter who you are, no matter what your background, no matter what the country, no matter how high the court decision is, we will all stand in front of the ultimate Supreme Court, the court of the Lord. Being warned by God in a dream that they should not return to Herod. So these wise men were guided supernaturally and sovereignly by God to the baby. He was already an infant, by the way, a toddler. So they are guided to him, and now they're also warned about this ungodly leader. Why? Because he's going to destroy. Look what it says. The angel of the Lord then appears to Joseph. So they went to their own country by another way. So they escaped Herod, and Joseph gets warned at the same time. And he tells him, get up, take the young child and his mother and flee. Go to another country, go to Egypt, and wait there until I bring you word, because Herod will seek to destroy him. So a false leader destroys life. And that to me is indicative. If a leader gets into leadership by guaranteeing the destruction of life, then they are a false leader. They may exist in their leadership. He did. He actually did. He lived as a leader until he died. But he is now known as the king who did this next evil thing. Obedience to God's word fulfills prophecy. He arose, Joseph did. He took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt. Notice what it says. He did it by night. Jesus said this to the people, to the apostles, be innocent as doves, be wise as serpents. In other words, if God shows you what's going on, use your noggins. He gets up and leaves at nighttime. Why? He has to escape. He knew who Herod was. There was a historical example of Herod's cruelty in time past. He knew that he was in danger, and Mary, and especially the child, was in danger. He knew that he had to be covert, so he leaves at night. And there, he was there in Egypt until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, out of Egypt have I called my son. There's a lot here. There's more here than I can even teach and preach about. But let's start with this. Joseph is obedient. His obedience fulfills a prophecy. What is the prophecy? I will call my son out of Egypt. There, God took Israel out of slavery in Egypt and brought them into the promised land. And now God takes his own son, sends him to Egypt, then calls him back out of Egypt, back into Israel. And it is a fulfillment of prophecy. Okay, so Joseph, by obeying the word of God, fulfills prophecy. Now, disobedience to the Lord, disobedience to God, and many people live as if there's no God. I'm atheist, I'm agnostic, I believe in all gods, I believe in all religions. Okay, if you're that way, you're also fulfilling prophecy, because that lifestyle and that kind of behavior was prophesied about by Jesus and all of the ancient prophets since long ago. Jesus said this, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be at the return of the Son of Man, meaning disbelief, atheism, violence, rejection of the word of God and the ways of God is going to be pervasive. Okay? So disobedience, if you're a disobedient person to the word of God, if you think that this doesn't mean anything, I don't need to listen to that, I'm in a different time. Okay, you're also fulfilling prophecy. You're fulfilling the prophecies that say in the end of time, people will deny the faith. They will reject Christ. They will reject the ways of God. You're also fulfilling prophecy. It's up to you. When he saw that he was outwitted by the wise men, Herod was furious. He was angry because the wise men outwitted him, he thought. It was not the wise men who outwitted him. They would have gone back and told him, we found him, he's down in Bethlehem, he's at this house. They were told by an angel, remember, we just read it. An angel warned them, don't go back to Herod. He's a bad character, he's a bad player. I don't want you to go back to him. So they were foiled not by the wise men, they were foiled by God. Rather, should I say, Herod was foiled by God. He should have been angry at God. Well, he is now. So Herod was furious and sent soldiers to slay all the children that were in Bethlehem and the surrounding areas that were 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had heard from the wise men. Remember, he asked them intently the time that they began to see this star, the time that God began to lead them. So they told him 2 years ago. So for 2 years they had been preparing and then began to follow this leading by God for 2 years. And they came to Jerusalem and they told Herod this. And Herod, not wanting to take any chances, decided, oh, I'll put to death all of the babies born before this time and this time. And not just in this area called Bethlehem, but all of the surrounding areas too, just in case. Maybe he got born a little bit outside in the country. So let's just kill all of the babies that were born all over that area, 2 years old and under. And he issues forth the command. He is a dictator, and the soldiers have to do what he commands, because if they don't, they die. So then was fulfilled Jeremiah the prophet saying in Ramah, there was a voice heard, lamentation and weeping and great mourning. Rachel was weeping for her children and would not be comforted because they are no more. So his disobedience fulfilled prophecy as well as Joseph's obedience fulfilled prophecy. There's a lot of principle here and there's a lot for you as a believer to see. Do not trust ungodly leadership. Trust God. Now, God knows what to do and when to do it. When Herod was dead, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, "Get up, take the young child and his mother, and go back to the land of Israel, for they are dead who sought to take the young child's life." So he got up and he took the young child and his mother and came back to Israel. So God knows what to do, when to do it. Even if there's an ungodly leader, God knows when to take him out. He takes them out. He raises them up. It says in the Bible, he brings them down. Even though there's an ungodly leader in power now, no matter where you are in the world, might be in China, might be in Vietnam, might be in America, if there's an ungodly leader in any capacity, God knows what to do about it. And he'll show you how to deal with it as well, just as he did Joseph and Mary. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for the example and the life of the wise men who, in their journey and in their seeking of you, they found you, they worshiped you, in spite of great opposition, in spite of great difficulty and personal cost, they found you, and they were awed and they worshiped. Help us to do the same, Lord. We're always in frightful times. There's always ungodly leadership, and there's a devil as well, and it's all around us. Help us, your people, Lord, to continue to serve you and search for you, that we know that you will guide us and that you will lead us. Come what may, Lord, help us to remain faithful unto you and true to your word. For those who do not know you, Lord, we pray for them because they don't know you and they don't understand the great privilege it is to have the King of Kings in their life, to never fret about leadership again, because you are the ultimate and eternal leader and you are the King that we really serve. And as the Patriots of America once said, We have no king except for the King of the universe. Amen. Please take your communion elements or prepare them for this Sunday's service, because we're going to have communion at the end of the sermon. So have it ready so that when we get there, you can participate. Okay? Thanks. Today is the first Sunday of the year and the first Sunday of the month. This is the day that we observe communion together as a church. So please, if you haven't been made aware on the email that Dory sent you, please go ahead and pause the feed and go get some bread and some juice or wine or whatever it is that you use, and let's have communion together. In communion, the Lord Jesus Christ took Passover. It was the Passover meal, a Jewish required festival yearly that they did, where they gathered together to remember the Lamb of God, which was taken by each Hebrew family, and the blood was taken and put on their doorposts, and the angel of death passed over them. Jesus came to fulfill Passover. John the Baptist identified him as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So communion is literally the application of Passover in your life. Have you taken the Lamb of God, Jesus, into your life? And have you asked him to cover you with his blood so that at the end of time you will not be judged with the ungodly, so that your sins may be paid for and your soul may be saved? That's the true nature of Passover, that the deserved wrath of God that should fall upon any sinner won't fall upon you because you've accepted the Lamb of God. Have you? I trust that you have. And if you haven't, you can start off 2023 by praying for him to come into your life, by taking his blood to apply to your sin so that you may be forgiven. Lord, we take this bread, which represents your body, which was broken for us. And we drink this cup, which represents your blood, which was shed for us for the remission of sin. Help anyone out there and those who do know you and love you, help them to continue with the knowledge of the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, which means my sins too. In Jesus' name, amen. So please take your bread and your cup and eat and drink. Amen and amen. We'll see you next week where we're going to begin a new series. All right.
Is it any wonder? Thank you so much for being a part of our service today. Thank you so much for worshiping with us and listening to the word. We pray that it blesses you mightily. Please share this video with your family and friends. Hit like and subscribe, and you can get notified when new videos are coming out. We'll see you next Sunday. Thank you so much.